And for all we know, Paul might have been making that up. How do we know he's telling the truth about that? So Paul is this young Jewish leader, a Pharisee. So he's very legalistic. If he had been a Muslim, he would have been one who is very, very supportive of Sharia law and would have followed that to the T. Paul believed that Jesus was a failed Messiah and a false prophet, and he was out to destroy the movement that Jesus had started. And then one day he had an experience that he was persuaded was the risen Jesus who appeared to him. And that experience radically transformed his life from being a persecutor of the church to one of its most able defenders. Most scholars believe that this happened within a couple, just a few years after Jesus' crucifixion. Now, Paul says in his letter to the church at Galatia, it's an undisputed letter of Paul, he says 3 years after his conversion experience, he went up to Jerusalem and he had a visit for 15 days with Peter, the lead apostle, and also he saw James, the brother of Jesus. And he wanted to go up there because he wanted to get a full accounting of Jesus, what he did during his lifetime. I think there's a good chance Paul saw and heard Jesus during his lifetime, because Jesus was up there at the same time celebrating Passover, all the festivals that Paul would have been there. Jesus created all the commotion in the temple. He was there with the commotion, the things where the Jewish leadership would turn him over to Pilate. And he had to know something about Jesus' teaching to think that he was a false teacher, a false Messiah, a false prophet. Doesn't matter whether he met Jesus or not at that point, but he wasn't a follower of Jesus during Jesus' ministry on earth. So 3 years after his conversion, he goes up to Peter and he says, Pete, I want the whole nine yards, give it to me. So he learns about Jesus during that time. In Galatians chapter 2, Paul says that a little over a decade later, he goes up to Jerusalem, and now this time he meets with the pillars of the church, and he names them Peter, James, and John. Now remember, he's already met with Peter and James once, but now add John to the equation. And Peter and John were two of Jesus' three closest disciples. So you got Peter and John plus James, the brother of Jesus. And he says, guys, in Galatians, he says he wanted to run the gospel message past them that he had been preaching to make sure that he was on message, that he was preaching the same gospel message they were preaching. And so he goes in there, hey guys, look, I just want to make sure I'm preaching the right thing here. All right, Paul, they sit down, you know, and they say, give it to us, Paul. And so Paul runs through the gospel message. All right, Paul, why don't you step out of the room for a moment? We'll discuss it amongst themselves. Just wait out in the hall. So he goes out there. They huddle up. Well, what do you think, Pete? What do you think? How about you, Jimmy? How about you, John Boy? Oh, okay. So now they sit down at the table, all three of them. He said, tell the guy at the door, hey, get him back in here. Paul comes in, stands in front of them. James stands up and says, Paul, we've discussed it among ourselves. We've come to a conclusion. He looks Paul right in the eye with all seriousness and says, Paul, you're good, dude. Keep up the good work, man. Fist bump. All right. So according to Paul, the Jerusalem apostles certify that he's preaching the same gospel they're preaching. Now, for all we know, Paul might have been making that up. How do we know he's telling the truth about that? So we look for corroborating sources. Many times in history, we never get corroborating sources. That's kind of usual. However, in this case, we're fortunate we do have corroborating sources. See, Luke corroborates it in the book of Acts. He was a traveling companion of Paul. But also, there's two guys. One's named Clement of Rome, the other's Polycarp. Oh, by some of you students in here, you're probably getting married someday. You're going to have children, a boy, maybe years ago. Just remember some of these names, like Polycarp, okay? So Clement of Rome was probably a disciple of the Apostle Peter, and then Polycarp was a disciple of the Apostle John. And they're both writing after Paul had died. So if Paul was lying, and his gospel message was essentially different than what Peter's and John's were, then we would expect them not to speak of Paul in laudatory terms. So it's interesting to note that in Clement's letter to the church at Corinth, it's called 1 Clement, Clement places Paul on par with his mentor Peter, and he refers to him as the blessed Paul. Polycarp, what he does is he says that Paul accurately and reliably taught the message of truth, And he quotes from Paul's letters a couple of times and refers to them as part of the sacred scriptures. This is not the kind of things you say about Paul if he was teaching a gospel that was essentially different than what Peter and John, the lead apostles, those closest to Jesus, were teaching. It's precisely the kind of things you'd say about Paul if he was teaching what they were teaching.